Hey everyone, I'm Elaine Welteroth, and for those of you who are tuning in for the very first time, this is Built to Last, a podcast by American Express, and it's all about highlighting the stories, the history, and the continued legacy of Black-owned small businesses that are shaping American culture. Thank you so much to our committed listeners who've been following along. Our debut season has received so much love, and we decided we just had to come back for one more bonus episode for Black History Month. Now, we all know Black history is made every day and should be celebrated every day of the year, but we couldn't pass up this opportunity to continue to shine a light on thriving Black entrepreneurs in this country. And if you haven't already, be sure to take a listen to some of the other episodes on Built to Last. We talk to some of the most inspiring Black business leaders of our past and present that continue to inspire us today. In today's episode, we get to talk about the drink many of us rely on to get us through the day. And yes, that is coffee. So I'm really excited about today's episode. And to help us uncover a not so well-known part of coffee history is writer, producer, journalist, comedian, and content queen herself, Danielle Young. Danielle's going to take us on a journey back to the early 1800s, where we get to know Rose Nicaud, the iconic coffee vendor whose famous coffee predates all your favorite coffee shops.
Coffee plays a huge part in the daily ritual of many entrepreneurs. Despite this significance, the history of Black baristas who shaped our relationship to coffee is largely unknown. Rose Nicaud, the pioneering entrepreneur regarded as the first coffee vendor in New Orleans, is one of the names history often forgets. In the early 19th century, Rose Nicaud sold her chicory blend of slow-dripped hot coffee to shoppers, workers, and fellow vendors at the French Market, a bustling open-air space that is still a popular destination among tourists and locals today in New Orleans. Every Sunday, Nicaud would also push her cart through the streets of New Orleans, ready to serve hot café noir or café au lait to churchgoers after mass. In the late 1800s, Catherine Cole, the first full-time woman writer for the Times-Picayune, wrote that Nicaud's coffee was like the benediction that follows after prayer, or, if you prefer it, the Benedictine after dinner. Rose Nicaud's coffee cart became a market favorite and a profitable business venture. But because Nicaud was an enslaved woman at the time, by law, she had to surrender the majority of her earnings to her enslaver. However, committed to starting a new life, Nicaud was able to work on the weekends and save a portion of her earnings until she was able to buy her freedom. As a free woman, Nicaud set up a permanent stand on the busy streets of the French Quarter, where her customers were able to sit, relax, and enjoy her famous coffee. In a 1987 edition of the Times-Picayune, journalist Marjorie Roll wrote, "Rose's stand was said to be the most cosmopolitan spot in New Orleans. Her kiosk even attracted many wealthy patrons who couldn't start their day without a cup of Rose's café au lait." While the success of Nicaud's work as a coffee vendor was documented, like many formerly enslaved peoples, historical data detailing Rose Nicaud's life is unknown. But we do know that her success was galvanizing. Rose Nicaud inspired many other free women of color in New Orleans to become les vendeuses, or what is more commonly known today as street vendors. Les vendeuses sold all types of commodities from coffee to pralines, building a long-lasting path for women in business to follow for generations to come. Rose Nicaud's influence cannot be denied. Not only did she inspire women in New Orleans to become entrepreneurs, her legacy laid the foundation for business owners today in both the coffee and street vending industries. Now, as we drink our daily coffee or visit our favorite food truck, it is crucial that we remember Rose Nicaud's name.
Yes, say her name, Rose Nicaud. For many, drinking coffee is a daily ritual, and it's a ritual that may not exist without this Black woman's legacy. Rose's story paves the way for our next guests, who are trailblazers in their own right, breaking barriers in the coffee industry one cup of coffee at a time. Without further ado, I'm excited to speak with Amanda Jane Thomas and Shanita Nicholas, former law colleagues turned founders of the famous Inglewood Coffee House, Sip and Sonder. So it's such an honor to meet you ladies virtually, and I'm so glad that we get to hear more about your story. But we got to start with our past, our history, and our shared history. So I'm curious, when you hear the story of Rose Nicaud, how does it remind you of your own story? And I'm curious what inspiration you've taken from learning about her life and her path to becoming an entrepreneur.
When I hear Rose Nicaud's story, and I'm just so aghast at how, you know, trailblazing she was in that context, in the context of being within an enslavement, being a slave within that moment, seeing her passion and her abilities to move into a space that I can't imagine how difficult, you know, that must have been to even think to move, and moving forward and that tenacity to do that. Be gone with what, you know, what I'm in, but you know, here's where I'm going. And so I think a lot of that similarity that I'm, you know, I feel passion from hearing her story of moving forward, regardless of what someone else tells you, you can or cannot do, or what circumstances say that you can or cannot do.
Yeah. You know, Rose Nicaud's story is really, it's really a story of resilience that resonates with so many of us. You know, being a Black woman entrepreneur, and even, you know, predating becoming an entrepreneur, working in, as Shanita described, corporate America, and really, you know, what it is to still think outside your circumstance and have what you call a dream, but then figure out how you're actually going to reach it, and against a lot of odds, right? And that's exactly what Rose Nicaud did. And, you know, to think that she, you know, was working weekends, you know, saving up, and really that grind, you know, that we talk about this grind culture that we kind of are all in. And it really is, we're on the shoulders of the original, you know, grinders like Rose Nicaud and the legacy that she's built. And then what she actually built is something that's also just so inspiring. You know, she really built community. And that's really something that I know Shanita and I can definitely, you know, relate to in terms of what we are trying to kind of keep that torch going and building community, and what it means to, you know, she had her cart and selling coffee and people coming to just, you know, sit, relax, and just kind of hold space, even, you know, just on the streets, and that being so powerful, especially at that time. And, you know, even though we're hundreds of years, you know, later, it's still being so important, having that, being able to hold that space. And that's a huge part of what we're doing with Sip and Sonder, and trying to do and keeping that torch, you know, burning, of what it means to actually have that space, and using coffee as the conduit for that, which is exactly what Rose Nicaud did, which is so inspiring.
I can't help but think about when you said grind. I'm like, coffee grind culture. I'm like, I can't help but make some, call out the bad pun. Y'all are both on the coffee
like
grind. So I just had to. It's like a bad dad joke.
It's
but
good. It's good. We're all about that. We're a corny joke. We love a pun.
So as you both know, Rose Nicaud is believed to be the very first coffee vendor in New Orleans. And similarly, Sip and Sonder is the first specialty coffee house in Inglewood, California.
Yeah.
I want to hear you guys reflect a little bit on what it means to you to be a first. And can you tell us a little bit about your journey of becoming the first specialty coffee house in Inglewood?
Yeah, you know, being the first in something, it's a huge responsibility, right? You know, the first should not be the last. You know, so by calling it the first, it's not just to, you know, be like, yeah, we were the first, like, let's pat ourselves on the back. Like, it's about now the door being opened, and now there should be more, right? There should be more Black-owned spaces and Black communities that are supporting the thriving of those communities. And really, that's, you know, Sip and Sonder being the first specialty coffee house in Inglewood. There needs to be other spaces like ours. You know, even if, you know, similar businesses, different, the idea of of what it means to create something that's nice, create something that has a premium product, create something that people feel comfortable, you know, visiting, but in their own backyard and not having to, you know, get in the car and drive 30 minutes. It should be in our backyards. And that really is a, you know, is a responsibility we take pretty seriously in what that meaning is behind it. You know, our path to opening Sip and Sonder is definitely not the easiest. We probably, you know, ran into every kind of story you could hear that of a pitfall or something that could go wrong in the process. We went through that, you know, but I think that, you know, along that process, being very vulnerable and sharing that with our community as we were building, you know, also lets folks, you know that the path is not always going to be easy. And yeah, like we thought we were going to be open last year and we shared that and look, here we are and we're not there yet. And that's something that is also part of, you know, that responsibility, right? Of being, you know, what someone said the first, it's being real about what the process is and like, what does that actually look like? What does it take? And that's something that, you know, we have tried to do and really being vulnerable, you know, before we opened, before we had walls and a bar, you know, we were having programs and events in our space. And it was that moment of, you know, is this a direction we want to go in? Are we ashamed, you know, maybe to have folks in before we start brewing coffee? You know, it's dusty or, you know, or it doesn't look the way the renderings look yet. But it was like, no, let's start to build that community. Let's start to, you know, just have that communal time with our community.
It's so refreshing, actually, to see two Black women share their passion for coffee. And you have this great success story with Sip and Sonder. And it's not until these moments where we stop and reflect and think, we talk about gentrification so much. And the issues with that. And I know every community I've lived in with that's predominantly Black, namely Brooklyn. I mean, as the nicer coffee shops move into town, they're almost always owned by white people. And there is this conflicting feeling that you have about going to get your coffee there. You like the idea of keeping, you know, keeping the dollar in the community, but I think it's really important that we come back into our community and we start businesses there and that we are able to keep the dollar in the community, but also in the Black community. Yeah. And I love it. I mean, you guys were talking about community building and space creating, and that's exactly what you're doing with Sip and Sonder. It's more than just a coffee shop. It's a space for fellowship, and it's an emerging staple in the Inglewood community for folks to connect, like you were saying, you know, and to build. So I'd love to hear you all talk a little bit more about what was the environment that you set out to create for your customers, and what do you want people to feel when they enter the world of Sip and Sonder?
And talking with our community, you know, what do you want this space to be? What do you want it to look like? What do you want it to feel like? And, you know, it's that intangible thing that you kind of can't put your finger on where, you know, when you walk into a space wanting, you know, when folks tell us that when they walk in, they just feel like they can like take a deep breath and exhale. That's it. You know, there's so many, I mean, that's a crazy world, right? There's so much happening and we need spaces where we can just exist, where we can just be. And that's really what the goal was in terms of, you know, the space that we're creating. You know, the truth is we don't need a lot of space to brew coffee, right? Like we have our Black coffee experience that we'll do kind of in different places in LA. We can pop up anywhere and brew coffee and make good and do that. But so it was really purposeful having the space that we have, a pretty large space, so that people can gather. You know, we have really high ceilings, but the little things like how do we make it so that it can feel airy so people can dream, right? But then also warm, so that they feel that warmth and that vibe, and really working with, you know, our team and hearing from people and really going about it very slowly, very mindfully and purposefully to build the physical space that we have, you know, and now with COVID, without having folks in our space, it's been that additional challenge of, you know, now what does it look like for folks to experience our brand when they can't be in our four walls, right? And how are we, what are the ways that we are still those same things, being authentic, being, you know, just existing, all of those things, how are we communicating that? What does that look like now? And that's really, it's an exciting challenge, and it's something that we kind of are knees deep in right now in terms of how do we continue to reach people? How do we continue to build community? How do we continue to, you know, they're not walking in physically and entering Sip and Sonder, but interacting with our brands in a way where those same elements and feelings still exist.
Right. I mean, listen, we're living through really challenging times, and the two of you are running a business together during a pandemic, as you mentioned, but also during social and civil unrest. It's undoubtedly a time of great uncertainty in this country, and particularly for business owners. So I'm curious to hear what are the unique challenges that your business has faced as a result of the pandemic, and also what does it mean to you in a moment like this to continue to build legacy through your business in this moment from a cultural kind of perspective.
Yeah, I remember the day, March 16th, we were on a call. And we had just decided, okay, we're going to put up some new, change the room around and make sure people are safe and do this and that. And then a couple of hours later, the whole world changed. And mm-hmm. It was like, we have to shut down. Like, we have to stop everything. And it was that moment when we, came to that decision of, we have to furlough our employees. We have, new coffee that just came in. What are we going to do with this? We have the rent is still due to, has always been due and never let up. And so it was that moment of, how do we game plan and strategize so that we're not just getting through it, the two of us, but we are going to move through this tough time and sustain not only ourselves, but our team and our community. And so, when we came in that next day and told the team, we had to furlough everyone. And we made it that decision very strategically, and in retrospect, I'm very thankful that we did. It was a tough decision. Mm-hmm. We weren't forced to furlough anyone at that time. But we knew, okay, how do we get everyone on unemployment so that they're still bringing in funds into their homes during that time? How are we going to make sure that, once we open, we're able to still engage with the community and be safe. And so, it was really tough to make that, but we were able to, kind of roll up our sleeves, game plan, get behind the bar ourselves. We became the
dust off our barista aprons
for a month. And, come June 1st, we were able to extend offers back to every single employee because of the pivots that we were able to make and the decisions that we were able to get through. And we are, still here now, almost a year later. And I think, those early on decisions, it wasn't easy. It still isn't easy. We're every day at least I'll kind of speak for myself, the 28th of every month, I'm like, okay.
The first is coming. I know. Let's look at those expenses.
Right. Maybe I'm good there.
And, it's funny because, to the second part of your question, what it means to be building legacy right now, I think that, I think those real moments where, we're pushing forward, we are forever, remaining hopeful and keeping our faith that, we've had really tough times but we've pushed through, and that kind of that resilience, right? Like that example from Rose Nicaud of really what that means, but, tangibly and in play, it really is something that kind of keeps us going, which is why, around the 28th, we can sit and be like, okay, X, Y, Z, A, B, C, in the next 2 weeks, we have to hustle and figure it out and somehow come up with this magic number. But we take on that challenge and we our team around us is part of that and building with us and can see it, our community. So I think that there's something about being very open. This is a tough time for all of us, but it's important to be very open and honest. And then be an example of, we don't always have it all figured out. We definitely don't, but we're still pushing through and we're still remaining hopeful and we're still, and then it does, and then eventually it does work out and we find a way, or, you know, an opportunity comes or what have you. It looks different, you know, month to month. And I think that that's the, you know, just a super important thing to kind of remember now, you know, ourselves, like other small businesses that really, you know, now that pushing forward, that you know, remaining hopeful, it can't be discounted, because when we're able to kind of look back, you know, and like, oh man, that was a crazy time. That's part of that. It's part of the story. It's part of the, you know, whatever that looks like in the future. None of us knows. I remember like it was yesterday. We were sitting, you know, kind of similar to where we're sitting right now. And it was, you know, we were 2 weeks shy of our 1 year anniversary. And we were like, are we really going to have to close our doors? And we were almost at a year. And it was like that eerie silence. You know, you could hear a pin drop, the tears falling, right? Because we feel, so not, you know, this is not to paint a picture of like, you know, everything, you know, rah, 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 every day. Like, we're human. Some days are better than others, right? Like, this is, it's part of that process as well. And also allowing ourselves to feel and process and, you know, which is also a huge part of it. Because without, you know, just because we have it kind of, I think, innately in us to be resilient doesn't mean that we don't feel and that we shouldn't take time to actually be like, you know what? Today's just not that day. Today's a day off, you know?
3 days in the woods. I was like,
I gotta disconnect. That's self-care, right? So that's also a huge part of it.
And I love that. I'm curious, what other sort of concrete lessons do you feel like you walked away with? Coming out of, you know, this really challenging season, not that we're all still in it, right? we haven't arrived at post-COVID times yet. But as you look back over the last 8 months or so, or a year, what are some of the concrete lessons that you've learned that you want to share with any of the, you know, entrepreneurs who are listening right now who can relate to that struggle?
Yeah. You know, I think one is, you know, flexibility. You know, there's a lot of, you know, our pivot that enabled us to really not just sustain ourselves, but grow, was really moving full-fledged into our roasting business. And, you know, that was part of our plan, you know, initially. It was more like, oh, you know, third quarter, fourth quarter, 2020, We're right. Getting there.
It got expedited,
but it really is, you know, the flexibility to kind of go with the flow a little bit and think outside of the box. You know, as business owners, any entrepreneur, you love what you're doing. It's your baby in a lot of ways, right? You have a certain notion of what it's going to look like, what it should look like. And I think that the you know, divorcing yourself a little bit from that and incorporating an element of whatever's going to happen that's kind of outside, that holds a place in this scenario. And so figuring out how you respond to that, and it's not overnight, right? I don't think that we've arrived there overnight. Certainly, I think we had to go through enough things where that didn't go the way that we wanted to then kind of have that little bit of a window where we're just like, okay, it is what it is. Tell ourselves that, let go in some way. There's only so much that we can control. And I think that, you know, I've had to, and this is both like personal life and professional, where it's just like letting go of a certain amount of the reins and letting things happen, but still being able to adapt. You have your goals, you have your dreams, you have your thoughts of what it looks like, where you should be by X time, and just all of the above. So I think that's certainly one thing.
I completely agree with everything Amanda just said. But in addition, going back to the beginning with Rose Nicaud's story, like, dream beyond your current circumstances. Mm-hmm. You know, I think that has been such a huge thing I've gained in this year. The thought of, you know, whatever it is that we might want to do, or, you know, have thought of and didn't want to say out loud, you know, it's like, say it, do it,
yeah.
Like, start moving towards it. And maybe it will look different, you know, mm-hmm. or maybe it will be even better than you ever thought it could be. You know, when we were like, we're going to start roasting in-house, in, you know, August during a pandemic, you know, never having, you know, brought a roaster in, you know, that that was a very dream big beyond your current,
like, speaking it into it,
and start moving it forward. And I am, you know, just such a strong believer in just saying what you want, because you never know who's listening, you know, or you know, what's going to happen as a result of that, or who you might inspire. even by sharing your dreams, you know, and I've taken, like, I've been the recipient of hearing other people do that. You know, Elaine, you were certainly one of those people for me and, you know, seeing the work that you've done. And it's just been, going back to that journey, I'm such an Aquarius, but, you know, being on that and being open to all the amazing things that can flow from that, even in the midst of adversity. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome. So many gems in there. So as you look ahead, and again, we are in such challenging times, but I think, you know, working within and for the Black community as Black women, I imagine that that is sort of the engine that just keeps you going. That's the motivation that just keeps you going, especially in times like this. And I actually want to ask you guys, in what ways have you been able to use your platform as entrepreneurs with this safe space, which it hasn't really been, you couldn't open up your physical space, but you guys still are a beacon within the community. How have you used that platform to inspire the community during these times, to serve the community during these times, to still continue building community, which we need so desperately during these times of isolation? Just would love to hear your thoughts about that element of this.
Our opening our doors isn't just so that, okay, you know, Sip and Sonder could say, you know, we're no longer closed down, but it's a question of now, you know, what is our team going to do? And, you know, we've been lucky enough to not, you know, extend offers to everyone to come back, but also hire new, you know, so we have new team members and, you know, someone new, you know, starting this past week, where that, especially now, super important to be able to provide employment within our community. We can provide that. These are traumatic times. You know, we don't, you know, often we're not talking about it like that, but the assault of everything that we hear and feel when we turn on the news is traumatic. Right. That it's having effects on us, our mental, our emotional, our physical. Right. That in ways that we haven't even begun to kind of see the effects of that. And so that's real. You know, it's a little tough with the complete kind of shutdown that happened. But now that, you know, outdoor dining is back, a lot of our activations that were still happening, we're very active using our mediums of social media in terms of that conversation that we're having with folks. You know, a sense of normalcy and being.
We're talking to one another and we were trying to figure out, okay, well, what are we going to do with Sip and Sonder? But then also beyond us, you know, how can we give back? You know, how can we be of service to other people outside of us? And thinking of, okay, well, we have coffee, you know, what can we do with the resources that we do have? And so we started doing weekly drop-offs of coffee and pastries and cookies at the hospital here. And it was, you know, I believe the hardest hit COVID hospital.
Sentinella Hospital.
Yeah. Every Friday since May 1st.
Yeah. You know, and we've been able to go strong since May 1st, you know, up to now, every Friday where we're delivering, you know, to the hospital.
Yeah, it was great that, you know, this morning we dropped off and the woman, every day she says it, we've gotten to know the team really well as well. And it's like, yeah, the floor, we provide to the COVID floors, and she said the floors, they just look forward to this every week. And it's one of those, like, we're thanking each other all day long.
Like, thank you. And they're like, no, thank you. We're like, no, really, thank you.
For all the work that, you know, you're doing for the community. And so that, you know, that is not a light thing for us to recognize that they're doing. But I think that's what we do for the community. That's how we support each other. That's how we keep, you know, moving forward. And the recognition that this is incredibly difficult timing, and it's very specifically impacting our community. And so let's recognize that and uplift and figure out solutions and how do we move forward and create, you know, healthy spaces for one another.
I love that story. I love that you guys do that community service every Friday. I'm so inspired by that. I feel like that needs to become a new hashtag, a new movement around Feel Good Friday. How do we give back one day out of the week? I love that. And what a great way to continue building community during these times that are keeping us separate. And maybe your doors aren't open, but you can go to somebody else's door and deliver your product and your service. And leave that mark that you want to make on the community. So kudos to you both for that. And I do want to go back to June. Take me back to, you know, the moment when the protests broke out around the murder of George Floyd and sort of how you thought about your role in the community. What role did you all play as, you know, as those protests broke out?
Yeah, there was, you know, and the way that we provided space pre-COVID, you know, we think about it the same, even if people can't be inside. Mm-hmm. And so being here to, you know, have a conversation with people, discuss what you're feeling. I know that was something we used to talk about a lot at the law firm, where there just wasn't time to process. There wasn't space to process, you know.
Right.
And I think what's so great about being in spaces, you know, whether it's Sip and Sonder or any other space that we get to frequent as well, is that ability of being able to just exist in your feelings and be with other people that recognize it. Mm-hmm. And so that was hugely, yes, hugely important for us. You know, it wasn't, you know, I don't think we did a lot of programming, though, like social media around it or things like that, but we were here, you know, and we had those conversations and, you know, we took in, you know, I think there was a march that wasn't too far. You know,
that came down Market Street.
Provided a coffee during that. You know, it's those on the ground moments of connection that are intangible, and it's hard for me to find the words for it, but I knew how much I was missing that before.
Yeah.
And so being able to provide, again, even just space, and I know the physical space has shrunk, and that ability, but space for feeling, space for acceptance, and space to not do anything but just be in that with people that are recognizing it.
So were your doors open during that time? Because a lot of businesses closed their doors. Yeah. Did you all keep your doors open?
So we did. We actually were closed up until June 1st. We actually opened back up, and you know we opened limited hours and storefront pickup only. And you know, it was that decision of, you know, all of the unrest that's happening. We just decided and made the decision that we can open in some capacity, bring some of our team members back. We have some of our folks that are regulars, you know, come, and they you know, even though they physically can't be in the space, you know, where if we're at the front, you know, social distance, but just sharing and communicating, you know, folks that have told us, you know, I really just wanted to be at Sip and Sonder, you know, when with this happening. And those words, you know, that's exactly the, you know, why we're kind of doing what we're doing, and the power that kind of, you know, as Shanita mentioned, having space and holding space for people. You know, we're criers, so there's always those tears. But, you know, the meaning and really being touched by, you know, the, you know, folks sharing with us that they still see this as a space that they can just have that space held for them, even though they can't physically, you know, sit inside. And that's really something that's just really, you know, remarkable and really inspires us every day, you know, literally.
You know, at a time when you don't necessarily feel safe and, you know, psychologically or physically, to have, you know, a Black-owned coffee shop in your Black community that is keeping its doors open, just if you want to walk by and
wave,
smile and wave and say, hey, girl, you doing good? You doing good? You good? Like, I know a lot
that's
of that
really
was happening.
Like, what is this?
Right. We just need that. And that's just that speaks to the intangible, you know, essence that you were talking about, that intangible value exchange of seeing a Black person owning their business in your Black community and just getting the opportunity to walk by and say, hey, girl, you good? And checking in on each other and knowing that your dollar is so well spent. It's going to stay in your community. It's going to, you know, cycle through, you know, the hands of more Black people. And I just, I get emotional about it too, because it is emotional. I'm a crier too. But in these times, it means so much to see Black women, business owners thriving and keeping their doors open by any means necessary, and even if they become virtual doors. So, you know, I applaud the two of you for pivoting so powerfully during this time. And I guess my last question for you is, with all of this sort of in mind and thinking about the times that we're living in and what you mean to the Black community, in like, I don't know, a few words, What would you say you want your legacy to be?
I'm like Shanita.
That's a big question, but it's Feel Good Friday. I just wanted to put it out there. Let's see.
You know, when I think about my legacy, and I'll kind of localize it to me and kind of broaden that to Sip and Sonder, it really is creating space and opportunity and structures for Black businesses to progress and grow. And how I see that within Sip and Sonder, you know, we have a myriad of stories that I don't always know until it comes out later, of people that are like, I wrote my website sitting in that chair, or, you know, I had that big meeting over there, you know, those moments of just even creation more than I could have imagined, for those moments to feel like of, you know, we created a space for people to do that, and we can use our own resources. I do startup law, kind of transitioning into more work in the shop, but that movement of even my practice to be able to focus on Black and Brown businesses and entrepreneurs, you know, that's the legacy that I hope to leave. And I think that we're building within Sip and Sonder as well.
Yeah. I think also, you know, Sonder is, you know, part of our name, and it's a word that is also just very, very meaningful to, you know, to both of us. And, you know, Sonder is the realization that everyone around you is living a life that's as beautiful and complex as your own, right? With their own ups and downs and their own worries and ambitions and craziness. And it's such a powerful word that, you know, if I talk about it enough, I'll get emotional, because I really think when I think about legacy, I think about, you know, what we're doing here at Sip and Sonder, and what I think is at the root of connection for all of us. We're really talking about empathy. We're really talking about that that connection and really love at the root of it. And I think that that's really, you know, for us to leave behind a space that really is centered on what it means to see someone, hear them, listen, and find a point of connection, even if we're on the surface so different. And that, and we can't, and it's not just, and it's not an impossible endeavor. We can. And I think that, you know, by having this space that we've created, literally that's why we exist, for that connection, right? We're using coffee as that conduit for it. You know, the creation that we're talking about, when folks can, you know, talk about creating their business here or launching, you know, XYZ here, it's from being able to have the space, the safe space to exist, to be, to create, to connect with others, and then all the beautiful things that can come from that, you know? So at the root, that's really like where I see, and kind of, you know, my personal legacy, right? And that empowerment that can happen, as well as Sip and Sonder's, where it really is just drilling it down to just at the root, like we're talking connection, empathy, and then like the flourishing of all of the above that can happen from that.
Tell me about the story behind the name Sip and Sonder.
Yeah.
What does Sonder mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, Sonder is it's a word I came across, I guess, probably a couple of years before we got together, and I had forgotten it until that moment. But it's the realization that everyone around you is living their own unique lives. It's that idea of being certainly an individual, but also recognizing the interconnectedness, which is at the core of what Sip and Sonder is. When you're physically here, you can come in a group, you can come by yourself, you can, you know, come in a different way every single day. I heard that word, and it's not in the dictionary. It's not like
it's not in the Oxford
word,
right?
I had brought up the name Sonder, and we were like, okay, that meaning, that's it. And we were like, sit in Sonder, like, what are people going to be doing in this space?
And then we were like, let's sleep on it. And then it was like, I think even later that night, I just texted Shanita, Sip and Sonder, you know, and it just was that eureka. Right. You're right.
I love an alliteration, by the way.
Oh, yeah.
I'm always
all about it.
I'm a writer. I have never heard that word before. And so you learn new things every day. Now that you've broken down the definition of that word, I'm so moved by it. I'm going to I'm going to make sure it finds its way into my vocabulary going forward on my Feel Good Fridays that I'm now going to, you know, I will be sondering in service to the community on my Feel Good Fridays going forward. Thanks to you, sisters. So as we wrap up, I just want to ask, what is one Black business that you want to introduce to the listeners of this podcast right now?
So I'll share. So there is a Black-owned brewery. Their name is Crowns and Hops. They are Black craft beer. Inglewood, they're coming to Inglewood soon. They're dear friends of the shop. They've always, you know, that's one great thing about the community here. We support each other in every way. And so they've been huge cheerleaders of ours and likewise. And they're you know, owing up and kind of growing and really it's great to see their expansion and just their growth. And so we love them dearly. Yeah. So I think that, you know, keeping it in the food and beverage family, Crowns yes. and Hops, definitely, I you know, I can't say enough great things. Check them out.
Good one.
Yeah, okay. I was like, oh, I got to say it before you say it.
I'll take it over to a fashion one. Okay. I'll say Filthy Rags, a location here in Inglewood.
Filthy Rags? Rags.
Mm-hmm. P-H.
Okay.
P-H-L-I-N. Okay. Yeah. Black woman owned, just amazing clothing and also amazing energy in the team. Mm-hmm. You know, they're kind of counter quarter to yeah. us on Market Street.
Yeah. But just, their neighbors as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, love all their energy. I went shopping there this morning. So they're, yeah, just a great team. Filthy Rags.
All right. Well, I love that Inglewood sounds like it's becoming this kind of hotbed of Black entrepreneurship. So I'm a new transplant to LA, but I plan to spend more time in Inglewood now after speaking with the two of you. I hope to get to meet you in person soon. I can't thank you enough for taking the time out today to share your stories with us. It's so inspiring. And I thank you for the lessons that you've imparted. And I just want to wish both of you the best that this year can bring and all of the success. And I will hope to be seeing you very soon.
Thank you. Thank you. And thank you.
All right. So what have we learned from the amazing founders of Sip and Sonder? Number one, never stop asking yourself, what do I want to be when I grow up? Two, dream big beyond your current circumstances. Three, stay flexible and be sure to always find joy in the journey. This episode has revealed just how important it is to uncover our history and the legacy of Black women like Rose Nicaud and make sure that their names are respected, honored, and forever remembered. Also, the next time you think about having a cup of coffee, take a moment to seek out and support Black-owned coffee shops in your community. I hope you enjoyed this special Black History Month encore episode of Built to Last. And if you haven't already, be sure to subscribe on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Amex's YouTube page, or wherever you're listening right now. And let us know your thoughts by reaching out to us at American Express on social media or by using the hashtag Amex Built to Last. I'm Elaine Welteroth, and you've been listening to Built to Last, a podcast by American Express. Now, before I go, let's be sure to remember the names, honor the legacies, and support Black entrepreneurs, not just from the past, but those in the present, and not just during Black History Month, but every day of the year. So go out and support the Black-owned small businesses in your community today. Thank you so much for tuning in, and we will see you soon. And if you want to support Sip and Sonder, head over to their Inglewood, California coffee shop, or you can also visit sipandsonder.com and follow them on social platforms at Sip and Sonder.